You more than you'll know. At times, even we don't love ourselves, but He still loves us. He still loves us. Lord, I thank you for this day. I thank you for this church that we can gather together, Lord, and speak and hear of you, Jesus. Lord, I thank you for your presence, God, that is in this place. Lord, speak to us this morning, God, through your word. Lord, you've already spoken, Lord. Lord, let us, Lord God, be attentive to what you would say this morning. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, musicians. Amen. I welcome you to the house of the Lord this morning. I welcome our guests. Pray that you feel at home in the presence of the Lord. Joyti, it's good to see you. Welcome. We had the pleasure of meeting Joyti when my wife and I ministered in Sydney in November, and it's good to have you with us today, Joyti. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Their names were Matthew and Pierre. And one day they received a telephone call. It was from a representative of a deceased estate who had in turn received this inheritance from another deceased estate. Several children had been bequeathed the estate. And this estate included a collection of old cars that had laid untouched for nearly half a century. Don't know if you're a car buff, but I like the old cars. You know, they have a saying, classic, not plastic. Those classic cars. In an effort to discover the value of the cars, they called the Arcurial, best known as France's leading auctioneer of arts and antiques. Over the phone, Matthew says, I gathered from the information given that this could turn out to be something important. Without realizing the scale, immediately we arranged to go there to find out what it was. Matthew recounts the story on entering the gates of the property. We had no idea what we would find. We had to go through the gardens at the rear of the property to get a first look. Across 3 hectares, we could see different makeshift structures. Low shelters covered with corrugated iron. From there, we realized that there was something big. We didn't know what we would be looking at, but we can make out the coachwork, weathered by time and the elements. Some were modern shapes, others were older. We continued our exploration at a second site at the bottom of a field. Then in one of the property's outbuildings, an old barn that had been converted into an improvised garage, they found this. Crystal, can you put the first picture up, please? The picture of the cars. They found this. They found 2 cars. Now, to the trained or the untrained eye, the one on the right is an Alfa Romeo, and the one on the left is a Ferrari. Now, this has been sitting here for 50 plus years. As you can see from the Ferrari, it's covered with books and all manner of things. It's just covered up. Matthew describes that you go into this profession for discoveries like this. This really is a treasure. Once in a lifetime discovery, he says. When we arrived here, we found ourselves overcome with emotion. It's just a car, right? Probably much like Lord Carrington and Howard Carter on being the first persons for centuries to enter the tomb of Tutankhamun. This is how they describe this find. So you've got this photo, these beautiful 2 cars. The Ferrari is a Ferrari 250 GTO California Spider. Don't know if you know about cars. It's powered by a V12 engine. Classic, not plastic. It's used for driving slowly nowadays, just cruising. You'll see them out on Sunday drives. We saw a few this morning, not Ferrari, so. There were only 250 of this type of car in existence, and the last one was sold at auction for $38 million. What's it worth? What's it worth today? At private sales, they have changed hands for $50 million. That whole estate of cars was worth over $200 million, just sitting there collecting dust. The next photo, please, Crystal. That just looks like a stone, doesn't it? Stunned miners have unearthed the world's most valuable piece of jade. It's an 18-foot monster worth $280 million. Workers were excavating rare gems in a remote mine in Kachin State in Burma when they stumbled across this huge jadeite rock. It weighs a staggering 175 tons, measures 9 feet high, 18 feet long, and 18 feet wide. These things are worth a lot of money. The car, this piece of stone, It's worth a lot of money to someone. But today, I want you to know that there is something in this room that's worth more valuable than the fancy Ferrari or the big piece of jade. There is something more valuable in this room today. You know, when we look in the Bible, we read the creation story. In Genesis, it talks about that there was nothing, and God spoke and said, "Let there be light." And it happened, there was light, and he said it was good. God created the land and the seas, and he said it was good. He spoke the grass, the herbs, the fruit trees, that was good. He divided the night and the day with a greater and a lesser light, sun and the moon, that was good. Then he created living creatures that moved, birds, fish, etc. Again, he says it was good. Cattle, creeping things, including spiders, and beasts of the earth. And yes, you guessed it. It was good. If you look out into nature and you see God's creation, you will see some beautiful things. And yes, they are good. They are amazing. And birds are so valuable that it says in Matthew 10:29, "Are not two sparrows sold for a farthing? And one of them shall not fall to the ground without your Father knowing." Birds are valuable to God. He created them, and yes, they were good. God's creation is beautiful, but there is something worth more than the sparrows of the air in this room this morning. Something worth more. He spoke it all into existence, and it was all good. The seas, the animals, the trees, the birds, the fish, with the power of his word. But when it came to you and me, he took time. Because we are more valuable than the animals of the field and the birds of the air. We are more valuable than the stars and the moons and the trees. We are more valuable than all of that. In Genesis 2:7, it says, "And the Lord God formed man out of the dust of the ground. And he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul." We were literally formed as if a potter puts a lump of clay on his wheel and starts to form something. God is a spirit. God doesn't have hands. So when he created us, something supernatural happened. And he breathed into us his own breath, the breath of life. Psalm 139:14 says, "I will praise thee, for I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knows right well." Do you know that you are fearfully and wonderfully made? Do you know that God doesn't make mistakes? Do you know God doesn't make junk? Do you know that today you are more valuable than the birds of the air? You're more valuable than the flowers of the field. You are fearfully and you are wonderfully made by God. But like in everything, we can lose sight of this at times. We can lose sight of the fact that we are fearfully and wonderfully made, that we've been formed by God and he breathed into us our life. We can lose sight of this. Sometimes the enemy of our soul can get into our mind, into our heads and into our ears because the enemy wants us to stop understanding what we're worth. He wants us to stop understanding who we are in God. He'll do whatever it takes to destroy us. He'll say things like, "You're unlovable." He'll say that you're unwanted. You're misunderstood. No one understands you. He'll say that you're a mistake. You're ugly. He'll say that you're a failure. He'll say that mistake you made last week, that's it. God doesn't love you anymore. He's given up on you. But they are all lies. He'll even go as far to tell you that you are a waste of space. You might as well kill yourself. He will do it. There's a common saying in our culture that says, "If it ain't broke, don't fix it." Basically means if it's functional, just leave it alone. If it's functional. And many people live their lives this way. If it isn't broke, why fix it? Sometimes their motto is, "My life is functioning just fine. It doesn't need fixing." But we aren't called to just function. We aren't called to just function where we get up, we do our things, go to sleep. That's functioning. He came to give us life and life more abundantly. But the enemy will get into our heads and say, we'll get to this point where we just function. We're happy living with the feelings of being unwanted, misunderstood, failure. We're happy to live with these things because we can still function with these feelings. We can still get on with life. We end up putting ourselves in chains, in prisons, in pretty prisons. What's a pretty prison, you might ask? Let me give you an example. David Novak had it made in the shade. That's what they say in America when you live in Florida. You've got it made in the shade because it's so hot and sunny. As the owner and operator of a flight school, his business contacts read like a who's who. He served as a consultant for Microsoft, worked with the entertainment business, various flight simulator games. He had the major contract for Boeing, defense and space. He had it made. He had a great life. But this high-rolling lifestyle came to a crashing halt, quite literally, when David staged a small aircraft accident in an attempt to defraud his insurance company. David pleaded guilty and was sentenced to serve 1 year plus a day at Elgin Federal Prison Camp, a minimum security facility near Pensacola, Florida. That didn't seem so bad. It was a prison, a low-security prison. After all, even to this day, this prison is known as Club Fed. Club Fed. It's a white-collar prison. Speaking of the who's who, David spent his time with Aldo Gucci, famous fashion designer. He spent his time with the conspirator of the Watergate scandal. He was with the who's who. David Novak finished paying his debt to the US federal government 2 years ago and since has released and authored a book based on journals he kept during his prison experience called Downtime. He also turned his prison sentence into a second career as a $125 an hour consultant, speaking to felons in the corporate world. He now lives in Oregon and has a client list that's some 65 federal jurisdictions wide. So he goes and talks to people that are incarcerated. So here's what David said about Club Fed. Remember, I'm talking about pretty prisons, okay, and how we can end up living in pretty prisons. This is what David said about his Club Fed. When you arrive at Elgin, your first view is a beautiful, wide, open space devoted to recreation. Basketball courts, soccer fields, softball fields. It almost seems like you're in a country club. There are old oak trees with Spanish moss. Aesthetically, it's gorgeous. There are no fences, no barbed wire, no guard towers, and it's Florida. The sun's shining. It's beautiful. You work a 40-hour week at Elgin, but other than that, you're free to do anything else within reason. There's free access to newspapers, to television. Lots of inmates work out diligently and actually leave the prison looking better than when they went in. Then, of course, people say, I want to get out of Club Fed. It's beautiful. It's got soccer fields, basketball courts, television and newspapers. It's comfortable. But with all the perks, there is one constant reminder that Elgin is not just another person at another resort. There is a yellow line painted around the border of Club Fed, and you need to stay behind the yellow line. Of course, if you wanted to, you could walk out because there's nothing holding you back. They call it a walkway, but the consequences are swift and severe. You will get caught, and then you'll have to serve an additional 18 months or more in a higher security facility. That's a very strong deterrent to walking across the yellow line. It may be pretty, but it's still a prison. In fact, one of the things David Novak suggests to help clients psychologically prepare for prison is to tape off a 6x8 foot area in your living room and get used to spending time there. Several of these pretty prisons existed in ancient Israel, according to the Book of Numbers. The Bible calls them cities of refuge. There were 6 of them, 3 on each side of the Jordan River, in the north, the middle, and the south of the nation. In this way, no one could ever be far away that they couldn't flee to one of these cities if they were accused of killing someone accidentally. The roads to the cities of refuge were kept in good repair. They were well marked, and some historians indicate that 2 scholars of the law were dispatched to run along with the accused to defend them if ever the revenger of blood ever caught up with them. Once inside the borders of the city, the accused were safe. Now, this is Old Testament. You can read about the cities of refuge in here. The revenger of blood could no longer harm him or her. He would be able to live, sleep, work, eat, shop, even play, but he wasn't really free. Talking about pretty prisons. The moment he stepped outside of the walls, he became a potential victim of violent attack to those seeking revenge. He never knew where it might come from, and worse, never knew when it might come. He could not leave the city walls for fear of his life. So while the city might be beautiful, comfortable, and even spacious, it was just a pretty prison. Life went on much the same year after year for the accused until the death of the high priest. This is where it changed. At the moment of the death of the high priest, he was free to leave the city of refuge without penalty. And the whole land became a city of refuge for him. He was finally, actually, totally free once the high priest died. Free to go back to his family, to go back home, to go back to his friends, to go back to his property, to go back to his possessions, to go back to his life. He was free. You see, in only one little area had he been free until now. His movement had been so limited, but it had been so long that he didn't realize just how restricted he had been. And this is what happens to us when the enemy speaks to our lives and we start believing his lies and we get on just functioning. We come into this prison where we're free to move as we please, but there is a limit to where we can go because he has got us bound. He has got us held back. He has got us in chains. We can become prisoners in pretty prisons. He had gotten used to bondage and called it his refuge. There was a whole world out there just waiting for him at the death of the high priest. It's strange how people can get accustomed to their prisons. David Novak says that there were times when he misses the freedom of all responsibility he had at Club Fed. But ask him today, now that he has a taste of real freedom, he's not willing to go back to Club Fed. Isaiah 28:15 says, because you have said, we have made a covenant with death and with hell. Are we at agreement when the overflowing scourge shall pass through? It shall not come unto us, for we have made lies our refuge. When we start believing the lies of the enemy, we make his lies our refuge. We are there. And under falsehood have we hid ourselves. Many people have spent their lives hiding behind the lie that they are free when they are in fact in pretty prisons, in bondage from the enemy. They are just functioning human beings. In North Africa, trappers have a clever method of trapping and capturing monkeys. A gourd is filled with nuts and firmly fastened to a branch of a tree. It has a hole just large enough for the unwary monkey to stick his paw into. When the hungry animal discovers the scent of the food, he will quickly put his hand in the gourd and grasp a handful of nuts, but the hole is too small for him to withdraw his clenched fist. The monkey doesn't have enough sense to open up his hand and let go in order to escape, so is easily taken captive. He doesn't realize that he has liberty to make a choice. He has the freedom to make the choice that will actually give him freedom. All he has to do is let go of that food that is in his hand. But the monkey is not smart enough. In our prison, the prison of our lives, we with the feeling of being unloved, unwanted, and unappreciated, we get to the point where we pretend that everything is okay. It's fine. It's okay. We put on a front when inside we are just functioning. Just functioning becomes our refuge. It becomes our pretty prison. The enemy of our soul, the devil, does not want us living for God. He doesn't. He wants us to just function when he's got the chain and he's just holding on. He's got us in bondage. John 10:10 says, the thief cometh not but to steal, to kill and to destroy. Jesus said, I am come that they might have life and they might have life more abundantly. It's not just functioning when it comes to Jesus. He wants to give you life and he wants to give you life more abundantly. The New Living Translation says the thief's purpose is to steal, to kill and destroy. My purpose is to give life in all its fullness. The devil wants to steal from you. He wants to steal from your present life. He wants to kill you. He wants to kill you so you have an eternal reward in him. He wants to destroy you. He wants to vandalize your legacy. He doesn't want you living for God. He doesn't want you serving God. And this is why we have such a high rate of youth suicide, depression, such a high rate of brokenness, because we have become slaves to our own view of our worth, our own view of our worth, and it's held us bondage for years. You see, when they were spying out the promised land, 12 spies went out, and they all came back, and they said, there are giants in the land. You know, we can't do this. We look like grasshoppers in their sight. Our view is very important. Our view of ourselves is very important. They weren't grasshoppers. But thank God for 2 spies that said, no, we've got this. We are able to take the land. It is important how we see ourselves. And we need to see ourselves how God sees us. He came and he died for us because he loves us. We are worth something to him today. As I said, those cities of refuge, the only way those that were incarcerated in there could be free was from the death of the high priest. Isaiah 42:7 says, to open the blind eyes, to bring out the prisoners from the prison, and to set them that sit in the darkness out of the prison house. Psalm 142:7, bring my soul out of prison, that I may praise thy name. The righteous shall compass me about, for thou hast dealt bountifully with me. In the Old Testament, there was only one event that could free prisoners from the city of refuge, their pretty prison. And that was the death of the high priest. So today, what can take us from our confined little refuge, our land, our pretty prison, into a land of possession? And that's the death of the high priest. Jesus Christ fulfilled that role for us. He fulfilled that role. Hebrews 9:24, for Christ has not entered into the holy place made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Hebrews 9:11-12. But Christ being come a high priest of good things to come, by greater and more perfect tabernacle not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, that's Jesus's blood, he entered into the holy place once, having obtained eternal redemption for us. He did it for us because he loves us. We are worth something to him. We are a precious treasure in his eyes. We need to stop believing the devil and start seeing ourselves how God sees us. We are special. Look at yourself and say, I am special. We can't look at yourself, but say, I am special. Oh, come on. Do you believe that? I am special. Wasted half an hour already. I am special. Come on. Oh, wow. We're awake. I am loved. I am wanted. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. All right, we're going back to the first page. We're going to start again. I think you believed it. And you know what? In the Old Testament, I've talked many times about lepers, and lepers had this terrible disease, and they couldn't touch people. They couldn't touch their family, their friends. They couldn't work. They couldn't do any of this. They were put away. They were put into a prison, the lepers. They couldn't live their lives with their families and friends. But Jesus, again, came to break the rules where we couldn't touch things. We couldn't touch. You know, the Old Testament, there are many things about not touching. But in Hebrews 4:15, it says, "For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was as in all points tempted, like as we are, yet without sin." I have a riddle for you. What's the body's largest organ? What's the body's largest organ? It's also the oldest organ. It's the very first one developed while you were growing in your mother's womb. I think I heard the answer. Someone said skin. Skin, that's right. It's not your heart or your brain. It's your skin. Yes, our skin is actually an organ with a function much more vital to us than merely being a wrapper to hold our body in place.
That's right.
It's more important than that. Our skin receives and sends all the vital messages our body needs. Hot, cold, danger, safety, pain, pleasure, love, care. Our skin sends these messages to our mind. Our other four senses, sight, hearing, smell, and taste, are located in specific parts of the body, but your sense of touch is found everywhere. Every part where you've got skin, your sense of touch is there. And it's in the palms of our hands and our fingertips that are the most densely packed with these sensitive tactile receptors. You know, have a look at your fingertip. They say there's about 100 receptors in each of your fingertips. It's the most sensitive part to touch. The most sensitive part of touch. So the act of touching or being touched signals more accurately than any of our other senses what the quality of our environment is. The quality of our contact, even the quality of our relationships. The sense of touch. The sense of touch. It not only provides protection, again, the dangerous aspects of the world around us, but it also provides us with the means of experiencing the wonder of this world as we literally are in contact with it. And so from the very beginning of our beginnings, we have been wonderfully and fearfully made to be sensitive, skin sensitive to all of God's creations. Is it any wonder then that from the very beginning of the very beginnings, the simple act of tender, caring, human touch has carried with it the profound qualities of love, of nurture, of security, of compassion, affirmation, and healing. The sense of touch is so important that infants die without it. Dr. Ruth Rice has spent many years studying the effects of loving touch on premature infants. She says the loving touch provides psychological benefits which have long-term effects. Through touch, infants communicate with their environment. Intensive care babies especially need loving touches from their caregivers to form positive, trusting, loving relationships. Her research documented these benefits. Babies gain weight faster, live longer, have longer periods of quiet sleep, they have neurological growth and development, and their development is enhanced purely from the loving touch of a caregiver. Touch, the Webster's Dictionary says, is the sense by which pressure exerted on the skin is perceived. That's what touch is. In the Old Testament, there were many commandments about don't touch. In the Garden of Eden, Genesis 3:3, but from the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God had said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. Don't touch. Exodus 19:12, and thou shalt set bounds unto the people round about, saying, take heed to yourselves, that ye go not up into the mount, or touch the border of it. Whosoever toucheth it shall surely be put to death. Don't touch. Leviticus 5:2, or if a soul touch any unclean thing, whether it be a carcass of an unclean beast or a carcass of an unclean cattle, he shall also be unclean and guilty. Don't touch. The don't touch commandments are necessary. It's true. Even for kids, raising children, don't touch commandments are very important. We say to our children, because if they do touch certain things, they can hurt or damage themselves. God's don't touch commandments were necessary for the same reason. If Adam and Eve had listened to one command, don't touch, sin would have never entered the human race. And you know what? It was don't touch until Jesus came. Don't touch until Jesus came. But then all over the New Testament, Jesus touched people. Matthew 8:15, Jesus touched her hand and her fever left. Matthew 17:7, Jesus touched them and said, arise and be not afraid. Matthew 22:51, Jesus touched his ear and healed him. Matthew 20:34, Jesus had compassion on them and touched their eyes and immediately they received sight. The whole multitude sought to touch Jesus, for virtue went out of him and healed them all. God was touching people in the New Testament. And people could touch God. They could touch God. We can touch him today. We can reach out to touch him, but we need to understand what we're worth. What we're worth to him. We are not unwanted. We are not a failure. We are not a mistake. They are lies. The devil is a liar, and he's the father of all lies. You are not a mistake. You are not unwanted. You are not unloved. While we were yet sinners, he died for us. He died for us. In the Old Testament, if you were a leper, the law said, don't touch. Don't touch a leper. But Jesus touched them anyway. Even while lepers were still unclean, still isolated, still ostracized, still ignored, still rejected, still shunned, still feared, still cast away, Jesus reached out and touched them. Matthew 8:3 says, and Jesus put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will be thou clean. And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. Touched him. See, leprosy in the Old Testament, as I said, you were put away. You were put into a prison. You couldn't have contact with your family, your friends. You couldn't work. You were put away. No physical contact, no hugs, nothing of that. But Jesus came and he touched the lepers. He brought them out of that prison that they were in, that disease that they were in. The woman with the issue of blood had suffered for 12 years, had tried everything. Every doctor had tried something, every medicine, every cure. She'd spent all her money and she grew worse. She grew sicker. But worst of all, her problem, because she had an issue of blood, made her unclean and shut her out of God's house. She was in a virtual prison. She was in this virtual prison. She could not get out of it. She had an issue of blood. No one could even touch her, or they would be unclean. The Greek words tell her story, let us know that this was a bad day to Jesus. The crowds were thronging him, choking, stifling, suffocating crowds. They were big crowds. They were thronging him. And in the middle, he's trying to help Jairus' daughter. She's about to die. And you've got to understand, if you touched her, you were unclean. The Bible says that the crowds thronged. The crowds suffocated. They were big crowds. So you've got this lady who suffered for 12 years walking through the crowd. They don't want her to touch her. They don't want to be touched by her. They may have known of her ailment. They may have known of her sickness. They don't want to be touched by her. They don't even want to brush up against her. She has lost relationship. She is in a prison. The crowds were pushed close to Jesus involuntarily because there was such a big crowd. But this woman got close enough to him voluntarily. She chose to push her way through the crowd. You know, when you're in a throng, if you're walking in a throng, you've just got to go with the flow. You've just got to go the way the crowd's moving. You can't, it's impossible to walk the other way. So the crowd thronged him. They just moved as he moved. But this woman chose to push her way through the crowd. For she said within herself, if I may just touch his garments, I shall be made whole. And look what happened as a result of one person touching Jesus. Matthew 14:35-36. And when the men of that place had knowledge of him, they sent out into all the country round about and brought unto him all that were diseased. This is from one woman pushing through and touching the hem of his garment. And besought him that they might only touch the hem of his garment. And as many as touched were made perfectly whole. Perfectly whole. Hebrews 4:15. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities. You can touch Jesus. You can touch him today as he's walking past. You can touch him today as he walks past, walks in and out of these aisles this morning, because he loves you. He values you. He wants to have relationship with you. Today, the enemy will continue to speak into your life and say you are worthless. He may even be whispering right now and saying, you're a mistake, you're a failure, you're no good, you're worthless. But I want to tell you today, you are not a waste of space. You are not worthless. You are not a mistake. You are not a failure. You are worth it. You are worth it. You were worth it. So he robed himself in flesh. He walked the roads. He suffered. He died. He gave his life for you because you are worth it. You are worth it. He died. He was beaten. He was bruised. He was nailed to a cross. He did that for you and for me because you are worth it, because I am worth it. He gave his life a ransom for many because we are worth it. You are not a waste of space, a worthless mistake, a failure. He loves you so much that he gave his life for you. He thought you were worth saving, so he came and changed your life. He thought you were worth keeping, so he cleans us up inside. He thought I was to die for, so he sacrificed his life. Why did he do that? Because you're worth it. You're worth it. Every one of you, you are worth it. He did it so you could be free from that prison. You could be whole in his presence. And you could go and tell everybody that comes your way of what Jesus did for you. Stand with me this morning.